So students, now let us move to our next chapter, that is chapter number 5, The Ailing Planet, The Green Movement's Role, written by Naini Palkhiwala. Now this chapter deals about the various environmental concerns and how these concerns are being taken care or rather been addressed by the various green movements which were being taken up at various stages in the various parts of the world. So, The Ailing Planet is a sad commentary that voices concerns and rings alarm bells to highlight our shrinking environment. The gradual deterioration of our environment is due to the staggering biological system. So, this as we can understand Earth to be a planet here, and the environment is getting deteriorated because of the various human activities. The main four biological systems are increasingly threatened by rising human population. They are fisheries, forests, croplands and grasslands. And now these four systems, biological systems, are being drastically under destruction, rather we can say lots of devastating effect has been seen in these ecological systems because of human activities. According to the writer, our earth is like a patient in declining health. Thus, we have to realize our ethical responsibility for guarding the planet. So, now it has become our responsibility to take on certain steps in order to make this planet to revive its health, because the author here, he has described the earth, Mother Earth, to be like in a state of sickness. It is ailing, it is deteriorating in its health. So, that is now here our role comes in, and we need to take up steps for that. Man's insatiable greed has reached an all-time high in order to save our planet. The green movement was started nearly 35 years ago in 1972. The world's first nationwide green party was founded in New Zealand. So, that when it was been realized as it was the need of the hour, the first green movement started as a nationwide green party from New Zealand in 1972. So, in this manner, the very initial steps were being taken up. This inspired millions of people at large, wherein for the first time people took the earth to be a living organism. In 1987, the World Commission on Environment and Development defined sustainable development as human development, which fulfills the need of the present without causing least harm to nature. So, now the World Commission on Environment and Development, they redefined that how we need to utilize the resources of earth. That means they gave a concept of sustainable development, where we need to take care, we need to fulfill today's needs in such a manner that we conserve the environment and the natural resources for our future generations also. Now, with this concept, these movements move further. Man has been considered as the most dangerous being on the planet. However, due to the efforts of a number of agencies all over the world, man is learning to live in harmony with the other living species on the planet. So, being an intelligent species, man has become a danger for the planet Earth, and that is how the people who had understood the need of taking lots of initiatives in order to heal this situation, in order to recover from this ailing health of Earth, to bring a harmony between the various other species which are being now endangered because of our over presence on this planet. Man's existence is shifting from the system of domination to that of partnership. So, gradually now earlier we used to dominate this planet with our presence, but now we have started shifting from this relationship, from a dominance relation to the partnership relations, where we are taking care of other species, of the environment, of the ecological systems on the earth. So this is how the shift has been, we are experiencing that it has been coming. One needs to be cautious in utilizing the available natural resources. We share this planet with 1.4 million living species, but ironically tend to lose 3.7 million acres of forest every year. We have an estimated 5.7 billion population. So with such a huge population, it gives lots of pressure, and like the planet is being stressed to fulfill the requirements, and that's why we are being exploiting and using all the natural resources. But we need to share this planet with other species also, and ironically we are losing acres and acres of forest every year, and that is actually the basic reason why the health of our planet is deteriorating. In addition to these, a satellite study of UNO shows that 88 countries have a critically polluted environment. The actual loss is much higher than we expect. The population explosion should be controlled, or poverty will become a matter of perpetuity. So basically our population, which has been increasing with on a bombardment, like a bombardment, it's been explosively increasing, and that is basically is the actual loss which has been distressing the environment even more further, and that is the where we need to understand that we need to control our population, or else we will not be left anything with to sustain further. The author re-mentions the holistic view of the basis of our existence. He points out that it is an era of responsibility that calls for seeing the world as an integrated whole rather than a dissociated collection of parts. So industries plays an important role in this responsibility. So with this holistic view, he wants the holistic conservation approaches to be taken by all the countries while indulging in various human activities. Even the industry has to take on its play its role in coming up with and taking environmental friendly activities during in their businesses. If we pollute our bed, it is we who shall have to rot in our sleep. So we belong to earth, and the earth does not belong to us. So that's what exactly he wants to convey, that we need, we being belonging to our mother earth, we need to take care of it. It belongs to the future generation, and that means we have borrowed it from the future generation. We have to we have our responsibility, so that we should leave a nice beautiful planet for our future generation. We should soon realize our duty towards our planet and should not treat it solely as our property. Today we stand on the brink of disaster. It is imperative to preserve natural wealth and resources for the welfare of mankind across the globe. So that is how our responsibility has enhanced and it has increased many folds in order to preserve or conserve our planet for our future generations. So students, let us see here, the chapter concludes with the beautiful lines of Mr. Lester Brown. We have not inherited this earth from our forefathers. We have borrowed it from our children. So that means we have to finally repay for whatever we are been doing. This is not an inherited legacy. Okay, we have to give this back to our future generations. So that is why we need to take care of this planet Earth. So with this message, the chapter ends over here. So students, our next chapter is a play, The Browning Version, chapter number 6, written by Terence Rattigan. Now this is an extract from his play Browning Version, which is a delightful play which orbits around an amusing conversation between John Tiplow, a 16-year-old student, and Mr. Frank Hunter, a young teacher. The play opens at the residence of Mr. Andrew Crooker Harris, a middle-aged teacher. John Tiplow reaches the residence to help the teacher in extra work, And as he had missed a class a week ago, in the short while, Mr. Frank also arrives at Mr. Andrew's residence. So, this is how John Tiplow, who was there to take an extra work, and it was the last day of the school and they were been expecting the result on the next day, and he goes to his teacher Mr. Andrews Crooker Harris, where Mr. Frank, another young teacher, he has also come to meet him. And here at this moment, Mr. Crooker Harris, he was not being present there, he has gone for some work. And meanwhile, these two, John Tiplow and Mr. Frank, were into the conversation. Okay, so both Tiplow and Mr. Frank talk to each other for a while. Frank is surprised to see Tiplow, who has come to help his teacher in extra work, even though it is the last working day at school. He is waiting for his result, which is to be declared the next day. The uniqueness of Mr. Crooker Harris is hinted as he does not tell the results to the students like other teachers. So, we can get here the in their conversation, they started discussing about Mr. Crooker Harris, because Mr. Frank also feels that his popularity among the students, the way the students were being obedient and they were being respectful for, even they were being fearful of Mr. Crooker Harris. Mr. Crooker Harris follows the rule of the headmaster. This was the first aspect, that he was been always abiding the rules of the schools. In the course of their conversation, Tiplow tells Frank that he dislikes the play Agamemnon, and he further tells that the play is not that bad, but the way in which it is taught makes it terrible. The play has too many Greek words, which makes it difficult for students to understand. So, Tiplow was sharing his disliking towards the play, which was Agamemnon. Tiplow plans to study science, which is Frank's subject. As per Tiplow, Mr. Crooker Harris is too strict and hardly human. So, meanwhile, this conversation goes on. Tiplow shares that how, what he is planning in his future, and that he wants to take up science stream. And then he shares about Mr. Crooker Harris, that he is a very strict disciplinarian and a person, emotionless person. Okay. Now, Tiplow appreciates his sense of devotion and rigid discipline. When he asks Mr. Crooker about his remove, he replies that he has given him what he deserves, no less and certainly no more. So, Tiplow was, though he was being afraid of his strict nature, he considered him to be very strong disciplinarian person, but then too he was being very devoted and very respectful towards him. And even he says that he is such an unbiased, impartial person, who that's why he says that he has given his the result, the score according to what he deserves. Okay, Mr. Frank is envious of Crooker's effect on his student. So, this is an aspect that why Mr. Frank was been motivating Tiplow to speak about more about Crooker Harris, and Mr. Frank was being quite envious, jealous about his popularity, the way he was being accepted by his student, regarded and being respected by the various students. Tiplow continues that unlike other teachers, Crooker is not a sadist, he is not a person who enjoys to punish the students, but he is strict, he is emotionless, he is a heartless person, he is hard like a nut and has no feelings. So, he does not reflect, he does not show his feelings, his emotions towards his students. Tiplow admits that in spite of all this, he still likes Crooker. He then narrates an incident when he laughed at a classical joke cracked by Crooker Harris, though he had not understood it. It was a gesture from Tiplow's side to be polite to him. So, he just shares this incident of his class where he was being very polite to him. Just then, Millie Crooker Harris enters the room. On seeing Tiplow waiting for long, she asked him to run away and come back after some time. See, then we, while this conversation was going on when and Teplo was making, he was imitating how Crooker Harris was telling the joke, and at that same moment his Crooker Harris wife Millie Harris, she enters the room and she asks that since Crooker Harris is going to take a long time, so he can go away. Rather, Teplo hesitates to go away for fear of Mr. Crooker. Millie assures him that she would take the blame. So, where Millie suggested him that he should take a leave for some time, he can go away, and because she understood that the boys of his age probably and on the last day of this session must have be wanted to spend his time to enjoy that evening, but he was there. So, Millie tried to relieve the boy. Being an intelligent lady, she so she found out a way, and she Millie hands over a prescription and asks him to go to the chemist. Despite all the problems, Teplo still has regards for his teacher, and he readily agrees to Millie and leaves Frank and Millie behind. So, finally, Teplo agreed to Millie's suggestion and he took the prescription, and finally, he went to the chemist to bring the medicines for Millie, and this is how we can see how respectful gestures Teplo was having towards Crooker Harris. So, this is the play which depicted a wonderful bond between a student and the teacher. Our next chapter, students for revision, is the chapter number 8, Silk Road, written by Nick Middleton. So, let us see the summary of this chapter here. This chapter describes about this is basically a travelogue which is describing the journey of Middleton to Kailash, where he has gone to perform a ritual kora, that is the taking a encircling the complete Shiv, which is considered to be a Shivling, and so that is to take the parikrama of that Shiv Mount Kailash, and so he has started his journey from Ravu village. See here the summary here. He left Ravu village and headed towards Mount Kailash. Lahmo gave him a long sleeved sheepskin coat. As just to see him off, he was being gifted with this coat, which would help him to take to sustain the cold of that region. Sethan, the taxi driver, knew a route to Mount Kailash, and he took that short route where there were lots of they were moving on the plains, and that route was a straight route to Mount Kailash. The shortcut took them across vast open plains where they saw the herds of deers. Okay, and as they moved on the plains, it became rugged and rocky. It was very rocky and it was not very easy and smooth ride. Okay, they saw drokbas in traditional attire tending their flock. Drokbas are the people who are having big herd of their cattle. Okay, and they passed nomad tent guarded by Tibetan mastiffs, a dog breed. Tibetan mastiffs are the guarding dogs, which are very popular amongst in this region and even in Chinese court also. So, the vision of snow-capped mountains and the valley where a wide river sparkled with glistening white ice. So, as they moved further, they left the plains, and finally, now they have been able to view the snow-capped mountains, and the valley started. They were moving along with the river, which was being covered with icy white layer, and there were sharp turns and bumps and enormous rocks with patches of lichens. The treacherous snowy track and the danger of cars slipping off the road. Actually, what happened was there was a snowy patch on the way, and Sethan just stopped in between, and then he assessed the road, then he spread the soil, and finally both the narrator and Daniel, who was one of the companion of his in this journey, they got out of the car to lighten the load, and Satan negotiated the hurdles skillfully. So finally Satan was able to manage that snowy patch, and they crossed it. Again there was another snowy patch which they just avoided by moving from the sideways, and in this manner finally they reached the top of the pass. It was 5,515 meters above the sea level. So the pass was marked by a large crane of rocks fastened with white silk scarves and ragged prayer flags. So when they reached at the top, at that height, they found a heap of rocks which was been which you can see was been bound by scarves, silk scarves, okay, the prayer flags, and there they took a rest, and Satan made the punctures to be of his stepney and one of the wheels to be mended. And meanwhile there was a tent, canvas tent, where the author, he had his noodles. It was a very dull, gloomy place. Okay, by late afternoon they reached a small town named Hor on the banks of Lake Mansarovar. So by the evening they reached the place Hor, and it was just at the shore of Mansarovar, where they could see the salt gatherers. Okay, his actual experience stood in stark contrast to the accounts he had read. In this Mansarovar lake has been described by various people who have visited Mansarovar earlier in their travelogues, but he found it to be very different from that. No vegetation, dusty, grim place with accumulated surface, and Daniel returned to Lhasa on a truck. So finally, he found that his experience was very difficult. It was a dull, gloomy place, and very lots of garbage was been there. There was hardly any vegetation, and he did not find the similarity between the description he had read with the place over there. And after that, Daniel, who was the companion along with him, he just he stopped there, and he took a return journey to Lhasa on a truck. Now with that, now the author was been going ahead along with Satan to reach finally Mount Kailash. The vehicle had two punctures, and they got fixed. Finally, after fixing those punctures, they headed towards Mount Kailash and reached Darchen, base town of Mount Kailash. So they finally reached the base camp. He was suffering, there were a lot of physical ailments, cold, breathlessness and heaviness in the chest. The author was experiencing all these problems. Physically he was not being fit, he was unable to sleep for the complete night, he was feeling congestion in his chest, and this was all because of the height, change in the environment and pressure, and because of that low pressure area, even the oxygen level was less. So he was been feeling very uncomfortable, and he was been feeling heaviness in his chest. So the next morning Satan took the author to Darchen's medical college, where he was been given medicines according to Tibetan therapy. Okay, and there the medicines provided him much relief. It was the doctor made him to he was being relieved because he started taking the dose, and he felt quite better the way he was been feeling the previous night. Satan left the author in Darchen. So finally Satan left the place, and the author was been left alone in Darchen. Darchen was dusty, dirty and thinly populated. The most of the population was from the tourists, and as it was the time for pilgrimage, but still there were hardly any pilgrims at that moment. In the dark cafe he met Nobu, Tibetan worked in Beijing. Nobu had also had to go for Kora. So when he was been there in one of the cafes, he met Nobu as he was reading novel. Nobu came and introduced himself. They spent time over there. Finally, Nobu came out with his intention that he being a Buddhist and a person from natively from Tibet, he was also there to perform Kora because he was writing some research papers on Mount Kailash. The narrator accepted Nobu's suggestion to hire yaks for carrying luggage and they moved on. So finally, Nobu became author and Nobu became companion to perform this Kora because Middleton, the author, he also did not want to perform this very exciting expedition to be done all alone because he was not much aware of that place. So finally, he accepted the suggestion to hire the yaks and finally they moved on. So students, now we have revised all our chapters, the prose section of our Hornbill book. So I would suggest all of you to go through the PDFs, read the chapters well, prepare the questions and answers and be thorough for your examinations. Thank you, students.